Good afternoon, parents, and a very happy Monday to everybody. I hope you've had a safe and relaxing and enjoyable weekend. And thank you to everybody who's joining us for this webinar in the series of parent information webinars that we have for you this term. Today, we'll be focusing on revision and home learning strategies as per the calendar. And today I'm joined by Areej, Asma and Mariam, who are our head student and deputy head students, and they're going to be talking to you from a student's perspective about some of the things that they have done in the past regarding home learning and revision. So we hope that will be very helpful for you to see it through a student's eyes as well as a teacher's eyes as well. As always, these sessions are recorded and then uploaded to the relevant YouTube channels at GFS, so you can please view these again or pause the sessions if you want to sort of think about that and talk to your child about it as and when you wish to, or obviously use that material if you've not been able to access the live event right now today. So we will make a start, please, and go through this session as we always do and start with the vision of the school to grow, flourish, succeed. We continue to remind parents, continue to remind students about this, these three very important words. Again, trying to contextualize it as we always do to these webinar sessions, revision, home learning. Essentially, if students get that right, it will hopefully result in success at the examination level or at the assessment level, whether that's in Key Stage 3, or even if it's just on a quiz or a very sort of micro level assessment that is held in the classroom. Next slide, please. Again, a reminder of the three pillars at Founders: mindfulness, language and cultural awareness, and character. We continue to talk about this a lot as we continue to battle through the pandemic. I think mindfulness today, out of the three pillars for me, stands out the most in terms of revision and home learning, and going back to what I said in the past couple of weeks about staying in the present and trying to control what you do in the present moment in time with your revision, with home learning, because obviously it is something that the students do outside of school hours, and it's very, very important to have the routines and the discipline, and I suppose that character as well, to make sure that they put into place a regime, a process that works for them when they're at home or when they're certainly outside of school, and something that they can continue to adapt and to change and to amend to make sure that they're getting the very best out of their home learning and revision experiences. Just another reminder as we begin this session that the live event question and answer is open. So please do, as you always do, post nice comments, positive comments. That's what we want from these webinars, to share the ideas even that maybe you've tried at home or that your children are trying at home. And we will publish those where appropriate and certainly answer the ones that are private for you. So that event question and answer forum is now open. Next slide, please. Just a reminder on the schedule, the upcoming webinar series. So we are 3 weeks in. Next week, we'll talk about the exciting curriculum plans. I'll be joined by one of our assistant principals, Ms. Catherine King, who's working with our head of vocational subjects, Ms. Angela Walter-Harris, behind the scenes to implement some new courses next year, as we continue to grow as a school. And then finally, we will have a session just dedicated to understanding your child's progress report and to go through the assessment in a little bit more detail so that you can further support your child at home. Next slide, please. So alongside this, I'm proud to announce that we have been working with a wonderful group of students, a small group of students, with regards to a GFS podcast and blog. The first two sessions or episodes, should I say, have been recorded and are going to be published to our website. So that's a very exciting new initiative, which myself and Miss Gabby Moores have been leading, But I've also now handed over that process to the students because it should be a student-led initiative. It will be and is going to be a student-led initiative. And actually what the podcasts will do when you listen to them is really help, it's for students to really help one another and provide some really good advice and guidance on different things, different topics, and students will be inviting other students to the show and to record with them. And again, this is a really supportive initiative. So please, when you have the opportunity, go onto our website. It will be in the parent newsletter as to how you can download the GFS podcast and blog. And I'm sure students are going to learn a lot from this, and hopefully parents will too. So that'll be a good thing to download and listen to at your own leisure and time. So just from my perspective, before I hand over to our three students today, I want to talk about some of the things that I have found useful in terms of trying to get the messages across to our students. And of course, this can apply to any student across year 7 to 13. Revision and home learning takes different shapes and forms as students move from year 7 to 9 when they're doing assessments or quizzes or tests, or whether it be other kind of external assessments in Key Stage 3. And then as they move into year 10, 11 and start their IGCSEs, where home learning becomes even more complex, becomes more rigorous, and making sure that the strategies are adapted and changed to meet the needs of passing GCSEs and getting good grades. And of course, becomes even more harder and difficult as students enter year 12 and 13, when they start preparing for very difficult and challenging A-level examinations. So hopefully this presentation will have some common trends of what students can do and perhaps shouldn't do, and some of the advice that we have got and developed, and over the past 20 years of doing this, figured out what has worked well and what has not worked well. But of course, we have to bear in mind the fact that society is changing, education is changing, technology is changing. So what worked 20 years ago might not necessarily work today, because of some of perhaps the distractions or the technological advances that we've experienced in society. But certainly some things that I think are stable in terms of organization. I have certainly used all of these with my students and the students that I interact with across different schools in different countries. And I think these are very, very basic things, but will be very useful if your child or children have not got these in place already. So when children go home, one of the biggest things I find is that if they're not organized and they don't have structure to their home learning or to their revision, it's very, very difficult for them to be as successful as they could or perhaps should be. So in terms of keeping records, having books outside of school that will help them document how they're going to learn, when they're going to learn, a revision timetable, and actually just documenting some basic structures is very important. I know that a lot of our students do use post-it notes, and I've talked a lot about this over the last few years, about using post-it notes to remind, to categorize different pieces of information, whether that's by subject or within each subject. And making sure that children outside of school have got materials, whether it's folders, files, index cards, sorry, or highlighters, actually available to them at home when they study. Because sometimes students will use their school books have their information in lots of different places. So I think one of the biggest bits of advice I would have for students and for parents is to make sure that it is centralized as much as possible for each subject, of course, and really well organized in terms of priority, perhaps, or by subject, depending on what your child wants to do. I think the area, the space, is so important. The more and more I speak to students, It's very, very interesting how they organize their own space at home. So obviously, learning, so parents with a dedicated area, office in the house, circumstances. Within that study. It sounds really basic, but getting calendars and then the examination dates. It's so important, this. We still see in education students arriving late for examinations at year 11 and 12 and 13, or frequently coming to school without the correct materials. That have been just reinforced so many times. Asking which room it's in. So all of these things create unnecessary stress on the day of the exam or the day before the exam. So we do provide this information well in advance for our examination students. And I think it's so important that that calendar is created, whether it's an online calendar or just a hard copy that they can carry around with to organize their learning. Likewise with Key Stage 3 students, trying to put into place and keep track of what's happening and when it's happening and how they're going to prepare is really important. The last one is quite an interesting one, but it's very simple and it's actually very effective. Morning or the weekend. That they can jot it down, whether that's before they go to sleep or if they wake up, because too often what we find is that students will be on devices, and perhaps you as parents will find this before they go to bed, and are documenting everything regarding their school on a device. And that, whilst it can be useful, and there's lots of amazing things down, is something that I would certainly encourage students to do. So please, on that slide, please just make sure that we work with our children at home to organise themselves when they do arrive home. Next slide, please. So this is about time management and not procrastinating with revision. So this is really the concept of thinking again about putting dates in the calendar and actually backward mapping and working backwards. Sometimes teachers will announce quizzes on the spot or tests or assessments, and that can happen. And that is normal practice in schools. And some will be scheduled, for example, the assessment fortnight or a GCSE or an A-level examination. But students have got to be prepared to take assessments and tests and quizzes at any given time. And this is something that we really want to make sure students and parents are aware of. So if students have a scheduled exam or a test or an assessment, obviously what we try to encourage them not to do is leave everything until the last minute, the last 2 days or even the night before to get their notes out and start revising. But more so, if they've got a test or an assessment in the next month, is to actually each night just break things into very small pieces, smaller chunks. And there's different strategies, and I'm sure the students will talk to you a little bit about different strategies they've used in how you can compartmentalize different bits of information so they're not overloading the brain each night when they study. So I'm talking about 20-minute, 30-minute blocks of chunking, making sure that they have a rest, and not saving huge amounts of time, blocks of time, closer to the exam or the assessment or the test, because more often than not, that doesn't work. I'm not saying it can't work, but more often than not, for most students, it doesn't. So thinking about when deadlines are, thinking about, again, going back to that organisation at home, how late into the evening, one, is your child permitted to stay up to revise? And what you find, what they find, is a reasonable time to stop studying, because every student is individual, and it's not all about home learning and revision. Outside of school, students have got to find that balance, and that can only be done in consultation with the school and with their parents, about when they have their free time, when they have the time that they interact in other things that is not schoolwork. So that balance, I will obviously leave that to you as parents to find out what works and what doesn't. I'm absolutely cognizant of the fact that for many of our working parents, there's that element of trust and responsibility that we have to give to our children, and making sure that when you're not home or you're not able to support them, they are acting responsibly and making sure they're managing their time appropriately and accordingly. Again, making lists in terms of prioritizing is something very, very basic to do, but too often students do not do this. So making sure they prioritize in terms of upcoming assessments or tasks. Next one, please. Again, this goes back to the environment. So assuming that the child at home has got a study space, a regular study space that they are familiar with, that they're comfortable in working in, you know, these are, again, top tips, really top tips, I think, that most students will say do help if they do do these correctly. So one of the biggest distractions, as we all know, is technology. And whilst it can be used very successfully and appropriately when studying, it's knowing how to access that technology and what to access and when to access it. So my strong suggestion is that mobile telephones are switched off. I think that's almost a golden rule to switch off the telephone when revising. And again, if students are using other devices, whether that be a laptop or an iPad, making sure that they disconnect or don't access email, social media channels and platforms, because that again, as we all know, is becoming one of the biggest distractions for children, not just when they're studying, but in their day-to-day lives. I've set several challenges to several students that I've been working with over the past few years to look at their screen time, to monitor their screen time and how long they're spending on their devices, and essentially what they are doing. And more often than not, when I speak to students and they share their weekly screen time activity, the majority of it is spent on social media platforms or gaming or things that will distract them from their studies. So I think that report that you can get very easily now from the different devices is important, but certainly closing them down, particularly mobile phones, before a study session starts or a revision session starts is absolutely critical. Making sure that the environment is quiet. Again, a lot of students will have access to televisions, making sure they're switched off. Even temperature and actual physical resources, you know, water. I can't emphasize how important this is, but so many students tell me that they're not keeping hydrated during their revision sessions and generally speaking. So please make sure that they do have access to enough water, and a lot of water actually, because that does definitely impact their ability to study as well. Next slide, please. Again, something that has been affected by technology, that sort of those day-to-day interactions that we have with our children, that we have with our students, and making sure that students are comfortable, that children are comfortable to share their concerns, to speak up, to speak out, if they've got a concern about revision or home learning or how it could be better. So please, and I'm sure all parents do this, but just continue to interact with them about how they feel, what we can do as parents and as teachers to help them more at home and in school, and to make sure that they celebrate when they get their revision right, or they feel that they've made a breakthrough in terms of a technique or a strategy, or that they've got the result they wanted on a test. and they felt that the revision helped, they should share that, and it should be a positive thing to do with parents and with teachers. And sometimes teenagers and students do not do that, but that sharing of success is really critical. And then conversely, the negative side of it, where students can get very easily trapped into negative conversation, you know, about we're all not going to do well in this test or assessment, it's too difficult, it's too hard. It's that the mindset that we've talked about in these sessions over the past few weeks and months, about making sure that students are really adopting that growth mindset, they believe they can. It's a can-do attitude, and I'm going to achieve this. And collectively working with other friends and students in the class or in their study groups to be positive about revision as well. If we can have the next slide, please. So in terms of motivation, intrinsic and extrinsic, so actually students identifying what does motivate them. And there's lots of things that motivate us in life, whether that's extrinsic things about, you know, holidays or treats or money, or whether it's that intrinsic motivation in terms of doing it because it's right and because it matters to you personally, and trying to find that, I guess, that balance of how students are motivated is really important. Obviously, I think goal setting, target setting is something that we talk to our student about, and making sure that they're realistic and smart with their goal setting, you know, and making sure that they understand where they're at, what grade they're at, and what grade they want on a particular test, but being realistic as to whether they can achieve that. And that all comes down to, like I say, smart goal setting and working with their teachers and their parents to build in that when it comes to motivation. Next slide, please. And then finally, from my side, before I hand over to Areej, it's actually managing that time. And like I said at the beginning, it's finding the right balance and understanding when to take time off and to rest and to disengage from schoolwork is absolutely critical. There's no exact science or formula to this, and it's about finding what is right and what is not right, and trying it and testing it. But I think chunking revision into smaller pieces, like I said, into that 20 minute or 30 minute blocks, is so critical, particularly in the lead up to an examination or to a test. Because I think students, again, too often, the more I speak to them, they overload themselves and they work late into the night, and perhaps do not manage their time as effectively as they could. And it's not easy, because this is about planning, and once students leave school to go home, they'll have a lot of things going on in their lives, a lot of distractions, like I've already said. So actually sitting down physically with you as parents, with us as teachers, and planning when to study, when not to study, and when the right time to have breaks are. We're certainly building in study leave for our older students. We've listened to them, and obviously with the current situation with the pandemic, we believe it's the right thing to provide students with study leave. We haven't in previous years, but we feel this year particularly it's going to be the right thing to do, and more information will come out to parents about that in due course. So I'm going to just pause for a second whilst we hand over to Areej, and then Areej will hand over to Asma and Asma to Mariam, who are going to give you some tips, some advice, some things they've learned throughout the time they've been at the school. As they now start preparing themselves for their final exams, their A-level exams. These are experienced students, very experienced students, who have proven time and time again that the strategies at home are critical. Their grades are evident, they're excellent grades they've achieved, like many of our students achieve. Like I say, our testimony are evidence of the fact that they've got things correct. but I'm sure they've also got lots of information and guidance about what hasn't worked as well in the past, and how perhaps their revision has matured over the years they've been with us at GEMS Founders School, and perhaps even how it will change in the future when they go off to university. So without further ado, I will hand over to Areej Khan, who is our head student, who will talk to you a little bit about her experiences and top tips. Next slide, please, Ms. Manning.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ian, and good morning, everybody. My name is Areej Khan, and I am a student at GEMS Founders. As a student here for the past 3 years and more, actually, I've obviously come across a few tons of revision strategies. I take sciences mainly. I've done physics, bio and chem and math, GCC, and I've also done bio and chem in AS and A-level. So I've had quite a bit of experience with the techniques used for revision in sciences. They obviously vary greatly compared to your essay subjects and your languages, which is why concepts and analysis are primary sort of areas which you have to focus on when you revise sciences. So we're just going to give you a quick insight into revision strategies and techniques of these three main areas within the subjects that we've chosen. Now in sciences, four sort of priorities, I would like to call them, would be active recall, mind maps, exam practice, and specialist vocabulary. Science is all about concepts and analysis, and as Mr. Ian mentioned, it's really important to keep these concepts in your mind continuously, and a part in doing that is active recall, using flashcards or even post-it notes to continuously just keep that memory jogged with all the key information that you need to know for your exams. You need to obviously space your revision out, and a good way to do that is putting it on a calendar, making sure you have enough time to revise for the topic. There's a lot of information that you need to know for just one topic, so it's good that you space it out and keep it digestible so that you aren't overwhelmed. And a good way to do that is mind maps. A technique that I use greatly is called blurting. So you revise a topic and then you take an empty sheet of paper, clear your mind, clear your space, and then jot down everything you know, and then go through it again later on and see what parts you've missed out. So it's something that I even do with my parents sometimes. They go through it, they time me so that I know that this is the information I have about this topic right now and I can further develop later on. Exam practice is so essential in all subjects, but I think with sciences, it's even more important that you do your exam questions. Your teachers, my teachers provide you with so many resources that involve exam questions, and even some questions of different boards, so you're more experienced with the content, as it is quite similar across most boards. So I don't think people should fret on, you know, the lack of resources in a certain exam board that you're doing. Just be open to it, do as many as you can, and obviously reflect on where you've gone wrong and where you've gone right, and celebrate where you've gone right if it is a difficult question you haven't been able to get before. The last one is specialist vocabulary. It's something that is quite overlooked sometimes, but keywords are very, very essential to getting all the marks in the question. And it's also really good to categorize all the information in your brain. So memorizing those keywords and maybe putting it on post-it notes or around your wall, or just putting it on flashcards, is extremely helpful. Coming to math, which is also a science, but it's quite different in terms of how you revise for it, it is largely practice-based. So exam questions are essential. And also, Mr. Ian did mention about, you know, writing down before you go to bed, if there's something you struggle with, just write it down. It's similar to what you can do for math. If there's a question that you're stuck in, just write that question down and take it to your teacher. I do it very regularly with my own math teacher, Mr. Edmund, and I constantly bring in these yellow sticky notes with questions that I don't understand, and he's always open to helping me out. And then I keep the answers that he's giving me and I put it there so I know that this is how you do the question. And making notes for math isn't quite common, but it does help, especially when you come to AS and when students come to AS and A-level. There's a lot of formulas you have to memorize, and there's a lot of techniques that you need to know and strategies. So maybe doing an example question and then putting it on a paper helps a lot. I've learned all these techniques like throughout my time here, and I could say that I've developed much more in terms of what sort of revision strategies I use from my GCC years to my AS and now to my A-level. So as you use them, you do find ways that, you know, suit you and that you can adapt to, and which makes the revision easier. So if one thing doesn't work out, try the next one and then try another one if that doesn't work out. There's so many to use, but I do think it's extremely important to find one that you can use before your exams so that you know you have enough time to, you know, use it for the best grades, which I'm sure everyone can get. Our next sort of point of focus is essay subjects. I will now pass it on to Asma Mulla, our deputy head, one of our deputy heads, to discuss that along with terminology and theories and how to revise for that. Thank you so much.
Good morning, Mr. Ian, parents, and other members of staff. My name is Asma Mulla. I am one of two deputy head students here at Founders. And today I will be speaking about essay-based subjects and revision strategies and techniques that you can use for them. I take geography, sociology, and English language, which are all essay-based. Other essay-based subjects may be psychology, English lit, history, etc. Two of the most important factors to consider in essay-based subjects are terminology and theory, both of which can really help elevate your answers to get into those top level grading bands in your exams. The first revision technique that I've always used is flashcards. With flashcards, I found that if you cram a lot of information onto them, they may get quite overwhelming to revise through. So what I like to do is jot down main terminologies and theories, the small explanation of each, and that's what I revise and memorize from. The second technique that is mainly used in your exam is planning. I think this is incredibly important, especially when you get to more of the long answer questions, such as 10, 15, 20 markers in your A levels, even 30 and 60 markers. You can do this in your exam. You just read the question, obviously analyze the source, and then jot down the key points that you'd like to speak about in your answer. And so while you're writing, you can go back, look at it, and then start writing the next paragraph. The third point is extra resources. Now, this is something I started doing more in my AS and A levels. For geography and sociology especially, I really like to research about the world, what's going on everywhere. I like to read a lot of academic books, interviews, videos as well, to show the examiner that I have quite a deep understanding. And once again, this is going to take your answer to those higher level bands. The final point is time management. Mr. Ian did speak about this, and I would like to tell you about a rule that I swear by, and it is used to calculate how long you should spend on each question. I call it the question mark rule. And what you do is take the mark of your question. So if it's a 6-mark question, you're going to divide it by 2, take that number and then add it to your question. So if I, for example, if you have a 6-mark question, then you divide it by 2, which is 3, you add 6 and 3, 9. So on a 6-mark question, you should spend about 9 minutes. For a longer answer question, like in my A-levels, when you have 20 markers, divide it by 2, 10, 20 plus 10, 30. So on a 20-mark question, you should spend roughly about 30 minutes. In this time, you should make sure to read your question, analyze your source, plan your question out, write it, and then even go back, read, check for any errors, grammatical mistakes that you may have made. Just to end off, I want to make sure that everyone understands that every student is different and you need to experiment with techniques and strategies and find what works best for you. I hope that this has helped and you are able to take these strategies and techniques back to your children and help them. And now I would like to pass on to Mariam Imran, our deputy head student, who's going to speak about languages. Thank you so much.
Hi everyone, my name is Mariam Imran. I am one of the deputy head students here at GEMS Founders, and I will be telling you some tips and tricks to excel in languages. So currently I do take science subjects. I take biology, chemistry, and maths, and I took physics last year. However, I did do French in my GCSE, and I did pretty well. So I actually had, I struggled a lot with French, especially in my first year. And it was these tips I put on here that really helped me to get the grade that I wanted. So the first thing that I mainly focused on was past papers. And I feel like this goes for all subjects. Practice makes perfect. Especially in French, you have four different exams. You have oral, writing, listening, and reading. Past papers really helped for listening and reading, especially since they're really similar. You can identify a pattern in questions and you get used to them, and that does make you excel. The second thing I did was I watched a lot of movies with French subtitles or in French. And the good thing about languages is that there's no restriction to your knowledge. You don't need to know a certain thing. You can use however many words you want. You can use whatever words you want. So the more movies I watched, the more subtitles I looked at, I learned more words. And this impressed my teacher. This helped with my oral exam. Also listening to music, I found a band that I really liked, and I would learn new words from there. Also listening to their speaking style, because the style we use when we learn is very different to what's actually used in France or another country. And it makes the examiner understand that you actually are fit for going to another country and speaking the way the locals do over there. The other thing I used was flashcards. Flashcards did really help with verbs. So a lot of languages, as compared to English, are very complicated. They have a lot of grammatical rules, and they vary from word to word. So flashcards really helped for the formation of sentences, and I think this is very important. The last thing was writing. The hardest exam for me was the writing exam. They would give you a question, and you would have bullet points, and you would have to target all these bullet points to achieve the full marks. And you can get any topic. Most of them is stuff you would be learning in class. However, the questions, you need to understand the questions, and you need to make sure that you've explained it in a way in which it is relevant to the question. You should not go beyond the question. So writing really helps. You need to practice writing. Write about anything. Write about your day, write about your dog, write about the food you ate. Writing helps with verbs, conjugations, grammar, vocabulary. It's beneficial in every way. And the thing about languages is that you need consistency. It's not something that you can do once a week or twice a month. You need to do it every day. My friend and I actually, we had a rule. We decided to only message each other in French. It was very hard and it was very funny because we would make loads of mistakes, but it really did help. And it's fun too. So I think that's a very good way of doing it. Also, I used to record myself saying sentences with the verbs so that it would stay in my head, and I would listen to it on the way to school in the bus or back home on the bus. And that also really, really helped. Thank you so much for listening. It was a pleasant experience telling you my tips and tricks. I'll be handing back over to Mr. Ian now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Areej, Asma, and Mariam, for sharing your experiences. I know that it takes a lot of courage to come on to a webinar to parents, and you all spoke very, very well about your experiences and some of the tips that you've used in the past and will probably continue to use in the future. And what I really liked about that was that it was very subject specific or area specific. So thank you so much for providing those top tips and guidance for our parents who have joined us today. Just a couple of questions that I've not been able to respond to, which I think are general questions, so I can publicly address them. One is about the past papers. So the girls talked a lot about the use of past papers, past examination papers, to help them prepare. It certainly is one of the best ways that examination group students can prepare for their final assessments when they reach year 10, 11, 12 and 13. The question is specific to year 8. My advice is that whilst students and parents want to get ahead and look at past papers, which there's nothing wrong with this, I just would err on the side of caution, not to overload your child too much too soon when it comes to preparing for GCSEs the use of past papers. The other reason I say that is that, and this links to the last question that we have, is where are the past papers, the extra resources? There is a wide range of places that they're accessible from, whether that's at the subject level or the teacher level or the department level. We have to be very careful as to which past papers we can release, because obviously they are used time and time again. And the exam boards are very cautious with this and do protect material and release it when it is relevant. Now, linking that to the examination board, this is a question I get asked a lot. One of the biggest questions is, why does Oxford AQA not have as many past papers available as other examination boards? The reason is simply because of the number of years that they've been operational. And it's not possible to create more and more past papers because they've only been operating for a short period of time in comparison to Pearson or AQA, where there is a lot of past papers. But what I also urge parents and students just to be cautious of is that not to go too far back with the use of past papers, because what can happen is students and parents will find materials from, you know, 2010, 2011, so on and so forth, that may be asking questions about a syllabus that is now outdated. So it's very important to work in collaboration with the class teachers and the heads of subject to make sure that they're accessing past papers that are relevant to the specifications and the updates in specifications. But certainly past papers are very useful. You know, I find it, having worked with lots of students using these techniques, simulating the examination as much as possible at home or the test at home, actually going through the routines of waking up at the right time, simulating lining up outside the exam room, making sure that you've got the right materials and all of these things. So actually, I think it's a very useful practice. But in terms of when to do it and how to do it, that will all come from the heads of subject and the subject teachers, all the assistant heads and the heads of year. Because like I said, many of the materials we cannot release, but the ones that we are allowed to release will be shared with the relevant year groups accordingly. Again, there's lots of materials out on the webs on the web. One thing I urge students and parents just to be careful of is if you're unsure as to the validity and the reliability of that information that perhaps you go search for on the web, please do ask teachers and myself or a school leader as to whether or not those resources are useful or not. The students will be given different resources relevant to their year groups, like I said, by their teachers. Once again, thank you everybody for joining us this afternoon. I hope these sessions continue to help. As always, it's always nice to hear some comments in the chat. If you have time to do that, please. Some positive comments or some questions or queries or things that you'd like to see added to these webinars. I once again thank very much the three students who have spoken with you today. And next week, I look forward to Ms. Catherine King joining us for the curriculum session. Stay safe, everybody, and thank you for joining us. Goodbye.